grace, we give you thanks that you call us, you send us, and you pray for our protection. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Our story from Acts is still in the first chapter. We've been listening to stories from Acts throughout this Easter season. You notice we begin this story, this episode, at verse 15. Prior to this, in chapter 1, Jesus has said, I will send the Holy Spirit to you. And then we have the ascension story according to Acts. And then we have this story. Jesus, right before he's ascended, says these words, you will receive the power of the Holy, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And who does he leave? He leaves those who had followed him. This day, when Peter's speaking, there's 120 people. But we know there's 11 disciples left, or apostles. Could you name them? Most of us know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We know those as the Gospels, but who were the apostles? I'm not going to put you on the spot. I can also say that if there were, this room was full of pastors, most of them couldn't name them. These are people who transformed the world after Jesus' resurrection, and we don't even know a lot of their names. Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, and Judas, the son of James. So they have 11. 12 is a great biblical number, the 12 tribes of Israel. They need to fill that spot. So they want someone who has been with them since Jesus was baptized, and they have it down to two names. They have the names of Joseph and Matthias. So how do you choose? They cast lots. We hear about casting lots 70 times in the Old Testament and 7 times in the New Testament, and we're still not sure exactly what it was. It could have been like sticks, and someone draws the short stick. It could have been stones, kind of like coins, and one would have stood out or been a different color. It might have been something like dice. It's probably equivalent now to flipping a coin. So they cast lots, or flip a coin, and the lot falls on Matthias. Have you ever felt like Matthias? All you did was show up. All you did was come to hear something. All you did was go to someone's home to hear about something you didn't know much about, or you just thought, I'm just going to blend in with the crowd, and there they are, choosing you. And you think, I don't have the skills. I don't have the ability. Why would you ever pick me to fill the 12th spot? And Matthias is chosen. One of the things I love about the Matthias story is we don't know anything else about him. Nothing. The only time we ever hear this name is in this verse we read today. We never hear about him again in any of the writings in the New Testament or even in historical writings. So people, of course, have speculated. Some people said he went to Ethiopia and was martyred there. Others said he went to Damascus and later died in Judea. Others said he stayed in Jerusalem and died there. But there is no historical evidence of that. He was called, he was sent, he went out, and he did the work, and his name is not recorded. You ever feel like Matthias, and that actually gives you hope? That I'm called, and I'm sent, and I'm given gifts, and it's okay. It's all right. I'm called to this place, to these people, and that makes a difference because we are gathered here today because Matthias went, even if we have no record. Do you know these names? Edith Carlson, Joyce Johnson, Mavis Hempeck. They made great impacts in their families, in their communities, and in my life. Edith was my great aunt. She had gone to finishing school. She could set a table with things that I didn't even know were part of a table. She knew etiquette that I didn't even know existed. And then when she was almost middle-aged, she married my great-uncle Charlie and moved to a farm by Tremont, Minnesota. Charlie knew more about coveralls than he did how to hold the right fork in the right way. Edith, to go to Edith's home was pure delight. What Edith taught me was you can be authentic wherever you are placed. She did not judge us farm people for our huge cookies instead of the dainty little ones. She never held it against us. But she offered us the incredible gift of hospitality and grace whenever we sat down at her table, which we did often. Joyce Johnson was my Sunday school and vacation school teacher, especially vacation Bible school, for most of my life as a student. and we went through 12th grade to Sunday school. Joyce taught me how to tell the truth. Joyce's 16-year-old daughter had been killed riding her bike a few miles from town. A truck hadn't seen her. Joyce told the truth about loss, about pain, about living with a hole in her heart. She also told the truth about God's strength and a community that would not let her in her pain go. They held her and still talked about her daughter, Lori, decades later. Joyce did not cave in on her grief. Instead, she used it to enlighten and to help student after student, year after year, learn about telling the truth about pain and God's love. Mavis Hempeck was my maternal grandmother. She taught me how to be strong and not be a victim of life's circumstances. She taught me how to speak the truth even if the person didn't want to hear it, who was usually me that didn't want to hear it. She taught me how to be steadfast and yet not lose herself in a relationship in which she stood by family and friends. These names are not going to be recorded anywhere, but what an impact they made in my life and in others. Matthias, we're blessed to have a Matthias in our congregation. We know nothing about this Matthias from Scripture, and yet he transformed the world. We are called to be people who go out in the world, in our homes, in our communities, in our vocations, and to be faithful. Sometimes we never will see the fruits of what we have done. Sometimes we stand up to injustice and we never get to see the system change. A name you may know is Lily Ledbetter. She worked for Goodyear for 20 years, and then in 1998, when she quit, she sued them because every woman did not get paid as much as the men there. It went all the way to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court did not rule in her favor, but Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg wrote a stirring dissent. And finally, in 2009, think about that, 2009, Congress finally passed the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act. She fought for something she never got to see the fruit of. And yet, she went out and did what she was called to do. This prayer of Jesus in the gospel, I think, was for Matthias and for Peter and Bartholomew. It was for Edith and Mavis and Joyce and Lily. It said to Jesus, Jesus says, make their joy complete. Sanctify them in the truth. Remind them that I guard them and protect. We are called as people like Matthias, who may never be written down anywhere else, and yet we go. We go and we do what needs to be done. In a monastic house, a new monastic house, there's a saying, everyone wants a revolution, no one wants to do the dishes. We're the people who do the dishes. We may never, ever have one person thank us. We may never have anyone say, you made a difference in my life. And yet the impact is there, and we are called, like Matthias, to go out and to do the work of God in our lives each and every day. I'd like to close with words by Walter Brueggemann. We carry old secrets too painful to utter, too shameful to acknowledge, too burdensome to bear, of failures we cannot undo, of alienations we regret but cannot fix, of grandiose exhibits we cannot curb, and you know them. You know them all. And so we take a deep sigh in your presence, no longer needing to pretend and cover up and deny. We mostly do not have big sins to confess, only modest shames that do not fit our hoped-for selves. And then we find that your knowing is more powerful than our secrets. You know you do not turn away. And our secrets that seem too powerful are emptied of strength. Secrets that seem too burdensome are now less severe. We marvel that when you find us out, you stay with us, taking us seriously, taking our secrets soberly, but not ultimately, overpowering our little failure with your massive love and abiding patience. We long to be fully honest, exposed to your gaze of gentleness. In the moment of your knowing, we are eased and lightened, and we feel the surge of joy move in our bodies, because we are not ours in cringing, but yours in communion. We are yours and find the truth before you. It makes us free for wonder, love, and praise, and new life.